I do spend a lot of time studying, especially, you know, masculinity, the psychology of men and masculinity. I think that's a pretty strong component of evolutionary science. It looks at how our reproductive drives get expressed. And my focus has been, you know, through religion and politics. So that's a big component of that, because, you know, we are reproducing beings. You know, that is a prime objective of all life, that you know, that is sexually reproducing. And it comes out in ways that is not expected a lot of times, you know, like in our religions, like in imagining a dominant male god in the clouds that really is intensely concerned about our sexual behaviors, that expects women to cover themselves to, you know, ensure those vows. Our gods do look like us. Our gods look like primates. But the thing is, we're primates. We are social primates, and we spent all of our evolution in dominance hierarchies. I don't believe masculinity is bad. There are many aspects of masculinity that can be good and pro-social, right? I mean, you know, men are also protectors, you know. Men are also scholars. Men are also nurturers, you know. And there's not just one kind of masculinity. So just because I tend to focus on the darker side of male psychology just because of the implications that it has for human suffering. Men commit most of the world's violence, which is not to be confused with the idea that all men are violent, but it is a male enterprise in so many ways. And in our evolutionary past, you know, it benefited men to, benefited their fitness to engage in violence on occasion. So, for example, there's a pattern that we see across our history as a species, where men would form coalitions, raid the outside tribe, slaughter all the men, slaughter all the boys, take all the females as their spoils of war, take all their goods. That kind of behavior has far greater implications for male reproductive fitness than female reproductive fitness. Women wouldn't benefit evolutionarily by tearing into the rival tribe, killing all the women, and mating with as many men as possible. Men did have an incentive to do that. And men still engage in that in some parts of the world. We see that behavior in you know, ISIS and Boko Haram have done that. We see this in the Bible as being ordered by God himself. You know, God told Moses, go into the rival tribe and do this. What I write about in my latest book is how when women are given a greater share of the, you know, a greater role in the political process, life improves for everybody. Because of their evolved psychology, because how it manifests in policy, education increases, social services increase, you know, medical care becomes more available. And part of that is because men have an evolutionary incentive for inequality. There's a reproductive incentive to have more than the other man, right? When Moses' men torn to the rival tribes and killed all the men, they took their women. They wanted what they had. They wanted more than their competitors. They eliminated their competitors. So to put this into perspective of how this translates to our reproductive biology, the person with the Guinness Book of World Records for the most children had 888 children and 500 concubines. He was a Moroccan sultan whose name was Ismail the Bloodthirsty. So rest assured he earned that moniker by slaughtering all the men from neighboring villages, neighboring societies, killing them, taking their women, taking their goods, to fortify his army, to build his army, I should say, and fortify his cities. And that was not an egalitarian enterprise. It was driven by reproductive greed. And so this psychology works its way up into how nations are governed, how tax laws are formed, stances on you know, equal pay for women or affirmative action, which all have to do with, you know, equality or having more than the other person.